I had stepped into a hole where concrete had come over my left ankle. I didn't know the severity of my injuries at that time, and I continued pulling non-survivors for another 24 hours. I returned back to my room, and when I sat down for the first time is when I realized that my ankle was being held together by my boot.
'9/11 was one of the most beautiful weather days in New York City. It was a crisp September morning.
I remember barely able to understand what I was seeing.
Looking out of my window and seeing smoke coming from the top of the World Trade Center. It was one of the scariest things that ever happened.
I was dropping my oldest son, Kyle, at his first day of kindergarten. And I was standing in this classroom, and an administrator from the school came down and said, Mr. Lutnick, they're trying to reach you. A plane has hit the building.
The first thing any television camera saw this morning was this.
I was based with ABC News over in the London Bureau when we were watching on screen this plane that ran right into one of the towers in the bottom of Manhattan.
Oh my God.
That looks like a second plane.
I was at St. Anne's School in Brooklyn, and our teachers coming in and trying to explain to us that something serious had happened. But I think every kid in the city really grew up that day, and it changed. The city wasn't a playground anymore.
Second jet come crashing into the second tower. What is going on?
The impact of that day on me and on my fellow New Yorkers and the whole world is I'm still wrestling with.
Oh my God, there it goes!
I looked up as soon as we got across the street. I looked up, I saw the building start, the tower start to buckle.
I happened to be on the street watching people walking from downtown. There was no other way to get out of the city, covered in white soot. It was the most terrifying day that I will ever remember in New York City.
I just turned and ran, ducked down, put a jacket over my head. Three or four of us huddled together, and it was just black everywhere.
Our tower was called One World Trade Center at the time, not the North Tower. I lost 658 people that day. Lost my brother Gary. Lost my best friend Doug. And I lost the life that I had before.
I remember seeing footage of people in cities all around the world crying, and you know, New Yorkers are often, we know where a lot of people hate us, but they didn't then.
Today we've had a national tragedy. Two airplanes have crashed into the World Trade Center in an apparent terrorist attack on our country.
I remember that day well, like all of us. I was a sophomore at the University of Texas on the morning of 9/11. I woke up and opened my blinds to see my Secret Service detail in the courtyard where I was living. I knew something had happened, and I was driven away, unable to see my friends or talk to my family.
I remember distinctly looking at the news, and at first, I didn't believe it. I put out a call for help in the sense of I was asking, what could I do to help out? I heard from the local blood bank saying that I should ask for contributions. And then I remember hearing back from them an hour later telling me to stop asking for contributions. Americans were standing up and they were already getting too many volunteers.
As testament, crowds of people flooded into blood donation centers in Georgia, Illinois, Texas, everywhere.
People donating blood, the line is here.
The city became the strongest community that I've ever known.
We got one out alive about 1 o'clock this morning, and then we got another one out about 5:30.
It became a family. A huge part of that is because of the military community and the way that they took care of us.
Another hijacked plane hits the Pentagon.
The impact of that day lives with me forever, unfortunately. Good day, I was being promoted to Lance Corporal from the Pentagon. During the promotion, the Twin Towers were hit, and we had no idea at that time. And within 15 minutes of my promotion, the Pentagon was hit. And immediately, we approached those who were exiting and separated them depending on their injuries. I had stepped into a hole where concrete had come over my left ankle. I had gone through 13 years of surgery, and I developed nerve damage, which began to spread up my leg and evidently led to the amputation of my left leg.
After the rubble was cleared, it was just the beginning of a long fight for the military.
The impact 9/11 really has had on my life is changed my whole mentality. I was still a young kid, probably 20 years old. Post 9/11, a lot of me felt a lot of uselessness. Felt like, what did I really join for? The next deployment that came around was in 2002, and it was a deployment to Bosnia. I'm thinking, oh, they're just gonna deploy us to Afghanistan and then leapfrog us into Iraq. And we've never leapfrogged into Iraq. We stayed in Bosnia. And that deployment really turned me into a lifer because I really understood what the spoils of war did. Every Sunday, I would volunteer and go to orphanages. We went on trips to like Sarajevo and kind of see like an Arlington type cemetery that's just kind of built up into the mountains, and it looked like a white snow cap. They're all headstones, and you're seeing kids playing in fields that are covered in mines. So many of us are struggling because we don't have people to talk to, or we don't know how to deal with a lot of things that we went through.
It was in 2006 when my life, my family's lives all changed. I was badly hit by an IED going down one of the roads in Iraq, embedding with the U.S. Army.
Being married to a war correspondent, I knew that Bob was putting himself in harm's way often. We became just like every other military family in the hospital with a loved one. And it was our chance to see what military families went through and the struggles that they had when they returned home after the wounds of war.
There are many other veterans who had been badly hit the way I had, and their lives were saved like my life was saved. But when they went back to their towns, they had to make some adjustments that nobody was really completely prepared for. People in the past, either they died or they lived. You know, now we got the kinds of wounds that made it much more complicated to deal with, many of them invisible.
The survivor's guilt is always there, wondering if I could have acted faster, wondering if I could have saved someone sooner. For me, it's the guilt that I live with, the nightmares, the PTSD. It stays with me always, unfortunately. And for me, it's just a constant reminder of what I have gone through that day. And now that I'm an amputee, it's even more of a constant reminder because my injury is visibly noticeable now.
But the government could not completely give the kind of care that was needed. We thought, well, let's start a foundation.
What's been so wonderful over the last 15 years, as the needs of veterans have changed and as the war has changed, is we've been able to change and be nimble about the kinds of grants we give and the kinds of needs that are out there. We do so much in the area of supporting caregivers 15 years after war. Also helping veterans transition to different kinds of employment and training when they can no longer serve. And then most importantly, especially now, is the area of mental health and suicide prevention and all of the wounds of war that have transpired in the last 15 years.
I just want people to remember, whether they're civilian or military, wherever they are, that you're not alone, you're not going through it alone, and please reach out and get help.
Hey guys, we are Lady A.
And this song is dedicated to those of you who have served in our military, who have risked their lives and safety for our country since 9/11. We've got your six.
Everybody I know wants to do something for the veterans. So in that sense, we are the ones that can guide those who want to help, want to donate, do something physically for the veterans.
Every September 11th, all of our families get together. We read our friends' names, we show their pictures, but we've turned to help so many other institutions. And Bob's Foundation has been a key part of that for all these many years.
As a New Yorker, what I'm trying to do for the people who protect us are to talk to them, to talk to the groups that support them, and provide help where it's needed. Supporting veterans and supporting their families is a personal top priority for me.
When I think of the military families and communities whose lives were transformed on that day and from that day forward, I think about sacrifice. And I think about how selfless it is to be in our military.
Their lives were transformed from that day forward, both on the ground in the city and abroad overseas. And I feel so grateful for the protection that they offered.
You are our ship steadier and the light in the night, and you take care of us, and we are grateful to you.
When I think about the impact of that day, I think about the tragic lives lost, the heroes who sacrificed and left behind families.
I really remember the firefighters, military people, and anybody who worked for a government agency suddenly was the most respected and loved person. I hope that's lasted. It has for me.
It is such a selfless sacrifice to fight for your country in the way that they do, and I'll never be able to fully understand it. And all I can do, the best I can, is honor them, respect them, and say thank you.
God bless.